Hello beautiful people, welcome back at Wisdom Garden with Erika Dell'Acqua. Hello, hello, so good to see you. Hi, come on in, say hi please. As you reach me, please say hi in the comments. We have so much to do today. We'll have to cram so much stuff. I know we lost the whole episode when Facebook and all the socials of the world went down, but we'll make it up. Hi, say hi. I see people, don't be shy. I need to hear your voice, guys. Come on in, say hi. This is a live show. I want your interaction. And this is brought to you free from Coaching Club Cafe. I am one of the coaches. And you can find me and all the other coaches at coachingclubcafe.com. Come and check us out. Every time one of you makes a new account on Coaching Club Cafe, it gets automatically 5 free minutes with any coach they like. So try, see if you like it. And we have lots of discounts and days in which we are half price or 1/3 off. And you can always buy a packet of time, which will be less expensive. Consider. Hey Silvia, good to see you. Hi. Hi Ariel, so nice to see you, girl. Well, as we wait, hey Fabrizio, hey Beverly, hi, so good to have you here, hello Melusin, nice to see you, thank you. So as more people come in, let's go through our announcements, guys. You know we have the House of Glamourgan Summit, World Summit. Conversation on Powerful Change. It's a podcast that you can listen for free, coachingclubcafe.com. We have lots of coaches and all of our coaches have a specific take on spirituality, a specific background, a specific bag of knowledge. We are all different. And the variety in us is fantastic. Everybody can find the sort of guide that will work best for them in Coaching Club Cafe. We are also working on a Hawaiian retreat and seminars. That's gonna be awesome next spring, April 2022. We have a 14-minute MP4 meditation with images from Hawaii for sale on our site for $10. It's a morning meditation, uplifting. And of course, we have our authors, because we do have a publishing house as well. And it's spiritual books for the most, but not only. I mean, Colors is Life from Anastasia has definitely a healing take. And many, many more. Find out the new book from Sky and the one from Anastasia, and we are looking for a new deck from Anastasia as well. I hope Anastasia is here, because I got an idea for you. We'll talk about it when we speak about the rain bags, but I think it's a good idea, Anna. Hey Julia! Silvia, hey! Good to see my people around. All right, guys, let's start. We have only this show before the show for next week, which is gonna be on Ogni Santi, which means all sense, every scent. We don't honor just sense in the Christian sense. Sense of scent, of course, it means elevated souls, at least in my eclectic take. So All Saints is All Souls. It's your grandmother too. Doesn't matter if you wasn't, she wasn't called Saint by some human organization. Today, we learn something practical. One of the way we have to activate an altar is sound. We use sound both to clean, or I can say cleanse more correctly, and to bring energy, to bring pepper, to call to us. So the bells, the sound at the beginning of a ritual, it's often an opening. And this is common in many cultures. I mean, you have people calling the other person to pray. In certain religions, you have the bell in church, both outside and inside. Sometimes you have drumming, that too is cleansing and also activating. Often we sound some sort of noisemaker like a maracas around the head of a practitioner before we are starting shamanic practices, for both cleaning them, clearing their head, and also at the same time calling their spirit, calling their helpers. So we can say that we are always in contact with helpers and guides, potentially. What we do when we call them to us, shamanically or with a prayer, if you're Christian, or calling the name of your archangel, or whatever is your method, is a way to make us more sensitive to them, rather than physically calling them to us. But what it feels like is that you can see your animal coming, you can see your angels coming. We are simple creatures, guys, and it's easier for our unconscious, subconscious, which is the child that has the magical wand inside us, to imagine that we call them to us, even if in reality we become more aware than them, of them. So, today we start with something that is dear to me, one of those sounds that can be rhythmic, which creates a neuro-explodent effect in your mind, and can also be almost white noisy. So it can carry you, like a drum will carry you in a shamanic journey, becomes a sort of ride for you. What we have here is the first ingredient we need for a rain bag. It's really thin. I don't know if I can see, make you see it. You see it? I think you can. You could use any metal wire you have at home, but I like copper for these things because it's a conductor of energy. So symbolically speaking, it really works for me. Carries electricity. Electricity is fire, is energy, is light. That said, if you follow the goddess, see if I can choke myself with my coffee like last week. This time was, it's so well stirred that I don't see a freckle of cinnamon on top. So I was saying, copper, guys, is one of the symbols of the goddess. Usually when I throw these pebbles at you, somebody asks, why? I don't want to give you too much information. Remember, you can always reach to me on Coaching Club Cafe if you want me to mentor you, to teach you every single detail, every correspondence, and elaborate on important stuff. For what we need in this live show, it's going a little fast, so I just throw informations at you, and you can take your time to develop information I give you, or you can reach at me, for me, at Coaching Club Cafe. Suffice to say that copper is a symbol of Venus. Venus means Aphrodite or Aphrodite for you English speakers. Venus means Venere. Venus is the goddess of love and she is the great mother, the goddess. We are accustomed to see Venus just as the goddess of pleasure and beauty because reasons, let's leave it at that. But indeed she was a much more complex deity, full of beautiful sides, including self-defense, including war, including love for ourselves. Venus is a very complete goddess. Copper is tied to the planet Venus, to the goddess Venus, and to green. And we leave it at that, or I won't have time to eat all the rest of the information I have to give you today. So this is ingredient number one for our rain bag. Ingredient number two, guys, it's a cat bell. By that I mean a bell that is completely round. It's like a closed metal sphere. Where do you find this stuff? Animal shops, usually, online, I'm sure. They have just a little cut in them to let the sound out. See? This is a cat bell. I hope you can see them really well. This is the little indentation they have. A hole, a cut, and another hole to let the sound out. So, what you need, guys, is getting at least three sizes of this sort of bells. If you want more, fine, but at least three sizes, small, medium, large. Remember, three is a magical number, works very well. Let's use our numerology. So, three is fine, you can have more, not less. What you do is that you take your copper wire or metal if you couldn't find copper, but strive to follow my directions, guys, if you can. And you start to beat them in. And we'll need also the third ingredient, which is indeed beads. You can use metal beads of all kind, like this one. You can use crystals. This is a Swarovski crystal. Can you see the orange one? And tiny other charms and spacers. This is a little rose, if you can see. Roses are another symbol of the goddess. Every flower is basically a plant genitalia and will come to be a fruit. This really embodies the generational power, the creative power of goddess and female in general, of course, with the help of male. So in this case, flowers or positive symbols, you can use Celtic symbols, you can use an ankh, you can use a triskel, you can use any spacer you want, but I suggest that you make it happy, you make it light, you make it cheerful. These sort of kettlebells need to spread out a sense of cheerfulness. That's how they clean the space around you. It's like children laughters. Let me see if somebody else is here or if they have questions already. Hey Karen, nice to see you. Welcome. Hello. Facebook is allowing me to see four comments at a time. at the time. So if I don't say hi guys, I will later on once the show is ended, and if you had some question for me that I did answer to, I will in the comments. Alright, so copper, kettlebells and beads, either flowers, symbols of balance, crystals. And here it's my idea for Anastasia. So guys, this gorgeous, gorgeous bracelet is something she made for me. It's part of a set. There is a gorgeous necklace with this. She asked me to choose three crystals I liked, and I just gave her color. I said white, translucent white and purple, and she made this stunning thing, which is so powerful and strong. I think this is Adularia, or is it Labradorite? Anyway, Anna, consider doing your rain bag using your own beads. I can totally see something like that made using amethyst and adularia and moonstone, labradorite, any sort of stuff. These gorgeous dark purple things, I think, are Swarovski that she used, which is exactly what I have used in this one. So, Anna, think about it. I think it would be such a powerful tool if you would consider making some rain bag with your beads and kettlebells. Oh my, it would be so powerful. So, copper wire, beads, and this is one method. You start with the small kettlebells, more beads, then you start with the medium kettlebells, beads, crystals, stones, natural stones, and then you go with the big one, the biggest one you have. Then you go back to the medium ones and the small ones. And then you have a space, guys, that is basically the handle. These are not bells, these are just beads that I attached here. So how do you do this handle? After you do the whole circle with the wire, you just go back and forth a few times. So this up here is just one wire, but up here I went three times, wrapping it on itself. You will end up, guys, with a loose point. Can you see it? What you need to do is taking this point and stick it in the bead beside it. So what I'm gonna do is fold it and stick it in the hole of the bead beside it, which is a little rose, and then I push it in. So it's now inside the hole and you don't have any pokey thingy that can harm your pretty fingers. Important safety. All right, so we have small, medium, large, medium, small, and a part up here which is about one third that has no bells. Listen to the sound. You can also strike certain bells. Or rotate it in your hands. This is the rain effect. One tiny little ding after the other, overlapping each other with no beginning and no end. Or you can vibrate it. And just let this cheerful sound, this sounds like children laughters in a spiritual way. Just clean the air, clean yourself, bring your vibration up. These guys, it's the other half of what I consider a rain bag. This alone could be considered a rain bag if you would put it in a bag. But in my tradition, which means yours too now, you're all my children now, we use two. We have two rings of bells. Hey, Maria! Wow, it's so good to have you! Hi, girl! Hello! Maria is a dancer, she is gorgeous and she has a beautiful soul. We are both ATS dancers and I'm thrilled to have you here. Lovely, thank you for coming. I hope you have so much fun, girl. Alright, we are talking about rain bags because we want to use them in altar honoring. We are gonna have a ritual next week, guys. Very glad that I was allowed to do that. Okay, second set of bells. So what is the difference with this one? In this one, we started with the small bells, then we reached the medium bells, so always interspaced with beads of metal and crystals, which in this case are a water green. Can you see this crystal appear? It's a little out of focus, but it's another gorgeous, real Swarovski crystal. Here it is. There are many. So we go to bigger balls and bigger and bigger. And then there is the handle. So you see, one, it's small, big, small. And the other one, it's small, medium, large. They sound different. You can do different things with each of them. Each of them having a part in which you hold them sort of look like a half moon, a crescent. Crescent? What we'll do is overlap them like this. This is a very powerful way of meditating. We just rotate it in a way or the other. We have many ways of working a rain bag, but we don't have the time to do a show on rain bag. I can go deeply if you wanna reach me at coachingclubcafe.com. I'll tell you everything about this practice. But for now, we need to limit ourselves or our hour. We'll be gone. Half of it is gone. Can you believe it? I cannot. So, first thing we do with this is finding a bag. This is super humble. I wanted it to look like the bag of a cottage witch. So it's linen, green, just rough. Of course, it's more powerful if you do it by yourself, if you do it with your pretty hands, especially in a full moon, especially in certain ways. But you can just buy it if you want. You put your two bracelets of kettlebells, one on each other, and then you shut your rain bag. Here we go. It's enough to just touch it, to carry it in your pocket all day long, to remind you that you have this ritual you wanna do, and every time you hear this slight noise, you send energy in that direction. Or you can hold it in your hands and use it as a cleanser. You can go counterclockwise, we call that Widdershin in magic, or you can go clockwise if what you want is bringing energy. We do counterclockwise to clean and clockwise to bring in. That said, if you feel differently, if you are guided to do differently, follow your guides. You know, we are eclectic. I am a chaos witch. And this is what I'm teaching you, to feel your intuition. This is a way that we will use, or we could use, to start our ritual on the 1st of November. A cleaning and bringing energy. Did you feel your heart going, oh, I'm lighter? While you heard this, the sound music is super powerful in our practice, in our psychology, to feed our emotion, to ride the waves of our life. Do have a soundtrack to your life, because your life will be better for it. And because you can use music to make changes in yourself. And guys, this is the secret of magic. Changing reality according to will, which means we change ourselves and how we see and how we perceive reality. Reality is also us, it's not us and reality in the outside. So use the tools that you have in your hands. Music, sound making, super, super important. Work it. Okay, so let's see another motion that we can do with our rain bag. And I would like to use this as a dance offering in our ritual on the first. If you are following Wisdom Garden, oh, Melusin is asking me, where do we buy the beads? If you mean the kettlebells, I found them either at Porta Portese, which is a huge market if you don't live in Rome, that is on every Sunday morning, or Melusin, you can find them in cat shop. And don't worry if you don't find them silver, it's fine if you find them gold, if you find them colorful, but do get them round, not half squared or other shapes. I want them round. Spheres, it's symbolic, it's important that it's spheres. Besides, the sound is different. If you don't find them around, guys, go online. You can buy a package of 10 small, 10 medium, 10 big, and or twice as much. And you'll do it. Yes, you'll spend a few bucks, but you know, it's worth it. This is a good tool for you to use. I want you to make a rain bag, we use it a lot. I think I'm willing to tell you, invest a few bucks and buy the kettlebells, like I told you. And the other beads, girl, you go in a merceria, a place in which you will find beads and trim lacings and stuff like that. And you go with your instinct. Now, again, I don't have much time today, but have you wondered why one of mine is green and the other is orange, beads-wise? There is a reason for it. There is always a reason in my chaos. My chaos is completely organized. Everything and me has meaning in my way of being chaotic. These two guys, let's take another minute to explain you a little bit more why they're so important for ancestors. The one that is small, then becomes big, and then becomes small, is the bracelet or the ring of the ancestors, because they were born, they had their life, and like we know the wheel of life is, then they became more weak and frail and died again, for them starting again, small when we are child, big when we are adults, small again physically speaking, because spiritually we are always more powerful, and dead for a while. This is the same of the wheel of the year. The death, the period in which we are not incarnated, in which we are reflecting on what we did and what we want to do, is north, is the darkness, is the underworld. Then we have east, that's the spring, that's the childhood, that's the small flowers, the tiny little green leaves that emerge. And then we have the south, which is the full of the sun. It's the summer of the year, it's the moment in which we work so much, but we also get the fruits. We are working toward our goals. We are at the top of the green lusciousness of nature. And then we have west, We have sunset. We have the moment of rest when the day is ending. And we have the time, guys, to sit on a porch and have a Guinness or a tequila shot or a cinnamon coffee and say, okay, look at our fields. It's time to get the harvest. It's time to relax and be on our rocking chairs with our feet up and one arm on the shoulders of my best friends and the other arm on the shoulder of my other best friends, and we just enjoy the sunset. It's the twilight, it's the end of life. And then back in the north again, in the winter, in the death of nature, and for us human, in the death of what is our body. Isn't this beautiful, guys? So, this is the circle of life, and I have orange because it's the color of Halloween, it's the color of sunset, of dead leaves. And why I have green here? Because green, this is us, it's the alive humans. Green is the light part of the year. If you followed my seminar for Pagan Pride Italia this year, we worked with Hawaiian red salt and Hawaiian green salt, and we saw light and dark half of the year and the balance that is the equinox, the autumn equinox. This is the same. One is orange because it's the candle flame, is the color of autumn leaves, is the color of a fireplace in the winter, is that golden color of the other world, the twilight. While the crystal on the others are green because represent us, which are on the light green part of the year of life, while they are in the bottom part, in the darker reflection, protect us from far away part. And we are green and have this different setting of bells because, unlike them, we are not dead yet. So we have non-life, childhood, adulthood, and the big, it ends with the bigger ones. We haven't done the fading of the body and back at reflection yet. So that's why the bells are in a different shape, because we are still alive, we miss a piece. And that's why I like to put them one on each other when we work with the rain bag on the ancestral altar, because we are overlapping the worlds. You could use them if you wanted, holding each in one hand. In my tradition, as in what I decided to do, what we have in the right hand, which is usually the dominant, is the ring of the life, which is the one with the green beads, I remind you, and in the left, the one of the dead. And we can move energies around our altar, we can call it in, we can calm it down. And this is dance, guys. We are doing dance. In our ritual, we'll do hand dance like that. We can send cleaning energy, and then we will go counterclockwise, like I told you. Just imagine you are clearing away everything that we don't need anymore, including pain for their departure, including selfish feeling of wanting to hold them here with us, including pain that we feel and it's not doing any good for our higher best path. And you can also send love. Imagine light from your heart, and now that you have your bells on your hands, you can take this heart and let them fill your heart, which will be clean and transparent, like I taught you the other episode, when we saw our five golden rules to create a trusting relationship, a two-way road with our ancestors and tap their power, make them proud. So this is how we use them in my tradition, often enough. We will do floreos, we will do ample movements, and we just enjoy the sound we make. But I wanna teach you another thing that we'll do in our ritual, and it's still considered an offering of dance. In the other episode, guys, if you're new, we studied my four healing offering for ancestors. Anything can be an offering, but a healing offering is specifically aimed at increasing our sense of uplifting, of wellness, of joy, of empowering when we deal with our ancestors and the altars. So in this exercise, guys, and you could do it without any bells, of course, but if you have a rain bag, by all means, use it. And it's tied with a symbolic gesture of receiving the blessing of the ancestors and also giving our blessings. We are humans right now, but we do have power. We do have karmic credit from other lives. We do have gifts. We have many of us as have powers that we can use to ask the source, the gods, Wakantanga, or how you see the divine, to help our ancestors. There is no forever rest. Yes, there are healing chambers, so there is a rest in peace for them, there is, but it doesn't last forever. Either they work on themselves or they work on others. So they do want our blessings, they do want our love, they do want our intercession for them to the source, to the gods. They want our blessing because we are their descendants. Like a descendant wants the protection of their ancestors, and it makes a big difference, it does. So the ancestors are empowered in having heirs, which can be blood but can also be spiritual heirs, that honor them, that ask to the source, bless them, help them in their work, give them power, give them light. Dancing, moving, silence, making noise, storytelling, it's all healing offerings and will be part of our ritual, which will be a very simple, brief thing, but I think will be important. It will be a bunch of people scattered in our blue marble, focused on a common goal of ancestral honoring. I'm sure it will do good to all of us and our ancestors. So back to our gesture. You take your bag, you can have the rings overlapped outside of the bag or in the bag, we still call it a rain bag. And you cup your hands around it. Now, ideally, your bells will never stop to make sound. And you attach your breathing to this. So, imagine that you are holding water in your hands, or if you are a dancer of it, yes, like Maria, this is the same gesture, Maria, that we use when we do the extended puja and we do the Vishnu honoring. When we honor Vishnu, we honor this very gentle, feminine, almost protector of life, while he's doing something that Christian call give the other cheek. Vishnu was attacked by all of his enemies, because who wouldn't hate somebody that is the preserver of life, you know? And what he does, instead of killing them all, like he could do easily, Vishnu, the preserver of life, dressed themselves like a beautiful woman and filled a tray of fruits and flowers and beautiful gems and delicious food. And since the enemies were in his castle, they were their guests, so Vishnu took the tray and offered it to the ones that wanted to harm him. And this is how he won them all. That, guys, is not a lesson on let other people tread on you. It's a lesson on try to take your enemies and make them your friend. So in this situation, what we do, we attach it to the breathing and we bring this tray of good, beautiful feelings of honoring and love. And every time we inhale, we bring it to our heart. Like if you're bringing water and your heart can drink it, like this. And then you exhale and you offer this beautiful sound to other. Let's try to do it for 3 breaths. And it doesn't matter if you don't have your bells, just rehearse this gesture. Imagine a sphere of light in your hands. How do you feel? Did you feel this sensation of being slightly lightheaded? We did it only for 3 breaths, and I doubt that you could all really sink into this exercise just the very first time that you tried. But do it, we'll do it in our ritual next Monday. So I want to really encourage you to play with this action. This will be part of our dance offering because we'll be sitting down. So we'll do hands and we'll do breathing. Take the blessing of your ancestors in your heart, which is symbolically the seat of feelings. And if you are an ETSer like Maria and I, we salute the ancestors in front of the earth when we do gratitude meditations. And then when you exhale, you bring your blessing to your ancestors. And it's continuous. See, it's like our breathing. You take, you give, you ask, you offer. It's a two-way street, your relationship with your ancestors. And this exercise can be done for a long time once you are accustomed to this sort of moving meditations, and will clean you, will center you, will lift you up, will empower you, will make you feel that sensation of stillness and floating of your mind. It's almost floating in water. In our special with Anastasia, we spoke about merging in certain alterated states of consciousness, like if we are entering water. It's still a natural thing, but we are not accustomed to it, so we need a special kind of breathing, a special kind of way of moving. We need to stay up, and at times we can merge deeply, but only for a little while, because then when we are in water we need to come back to air, to light. The more you merge in water, the more darkness we'll find. And this is in conscious, subconscious. Will I ever learn that, guys? It's okay, we're a little scared, but we shouldn't let that stop us. So I really want you, for the next time I see you, to work with this gesture of offering to your ancestors and taking what they have to offer you. Offering actions like cleaning your altar, like offering clear water, and also take their protection. Don't be afraid of claiming them as your ancestors, as your lineage. Show yourself as their heir. Make them proud. Let me check on the time. Oh, good gosh. Okay, let's go ahead. So, guys, let's take some time to see what we need for an altar next week. If you can, this, otherwise, any other kind of sound maker. I have a fast, quick solution for people that don't wanna work with bells for any reason, or maybe you don't wanna spend the money. We are all in dire situations economically in the world right now, so I understand if you don't wanna spend money in this moment. I'll offer you an alternative to make sound, and this, it's a possibility. This is a glass jar. It was fruit juice. I colored the top black, and then I used the glass colors, but it's not necessary, of course, to create all sorts of vines around it. After which I filled it with rice, green beans, that's soy that you see inside, red beans, green and red, we know why now, and I don't know if you can see it, but there are copper wires, copper nails inside. And these guys, it's the same symbol that I wanted for the wire of the bells. Goddess. Copper nails. You can find them relatively easy. Any ferramenta, if you're Italian, hardware shop, if you're not. You can probably not see, but the nail is not round, is squared, has four sides. And that too is symbolic for me, because four elements. And of course the head instead is circular, which is the circle that encompasses the four elements. So rice, beads, if you want you could put something metal in it, even some crystals if you wanted, like we did for the bracelet, and an element of copper. And this can be an alternative. It has a certain maracas feel. I use it like I would use other maracas-like instrument in shamanic practices sometimes. So I gave you a cheap alternative. You must have a bottle, a mason jar. You just put some rice in it, some metal things that rattles, and here's your instrument. And you can do our magical dance offering and bringing it to you. Offering the ancestors, taking the blessings, giving while you exhale and taking while you inhale. Hurry, 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 Erica. Next week, we'll have our altar and the two very main necessary elements that we need are light slash fire and water. So, guys, if you don't have anything, any instrument at all, I always teach my students to have an option for impromptu magic, magic wherever you are with no tools but yourself. So what do you do, guys, if you come to me next week with no tools whatsoever? As you'll follow, I want you to visualize light. Just closing your eyes and imagine light of any sort. It can be a golden light around your head, behind your eyes, in your heart. It can be a silver glow all around you. It can be green light from your heart. The important is that you close your eyes and you visualize light, and you are the water. You are water. You are made mostly of water. You have rivers in your body. You have streams and tiny creeks and huge, large veins that are equivalent to huge rivers. You have water in your sex, you have water when you are born, you were swimming in water before you were born, you have water in your mouth, you emit water when you cry, you emit water when you are happy. And where is the light in you? Light, electricity. We are energy, we are light. Our heart pulses. Because every time it beats, there is an electrical impulse in it. So we do embody all the elements. We really, really do. All of them. You know, in your body, in your bloodstream, you have iron. A metal. Iron. Ferro in Italian. That is earth, and this iron, this metal, flows in your blood, flows in the stream of the red waters of your body. That is water that you have in you. And you know why this iron is in the water of the rivers of your body? Because it helps you bring and use oxygen. Oxygen is air. Oxygen, it's created by other forms of life that is not you. We humans do not create oxygen. other species create oxygen for us. Do you realize how we are interlaced with Gaia, with nature, with the planet? And bringing air, oxygen, through the water of your blood, with the help of the iron earth in your body, means that the cells of your body can receive the oxygen and create fire, create energy, produce heat, live fire. So see, you have all the elements in you. You can absolutely be the altar of your ancestors with the light you envision, with the electricity of your heartbeat, and with the water that you are. Now, if we can instead have some tools, the two ones that will be the first thing that you need, it will be, as we said in the other shows, and if you haven't watched them, go watch them. Water, ideally filled to the brim, and a candle. Now, we could have the candle in front or behind. If you gave a good look to the photo of the altar that I posted in the discussion in the event of today's show, you might see that is set in a way in which the practitioner has the candle in front, then there is a glass of water behind, and there is a wall in the back. So when I light my candle, what I see is a projection of the light that went through the glass of water and created an image in the back wall. Now you can see it too well from this image, but it almost appears like a face and hair. Sometimes in magic, in meditation, in spirituality, we use these ghost images as a mandala, you would say, of the mind. As a mandala in the sense that you put your eyes in it and then you relax, and sometimes your fantasy will actually show a face there. Somebody that looks like a light elf, and that will be the face of your ancestors in that moment. You can just rest your eyes on this image, just look without any intention, and sometimes this image speaks back to you. It's all in our minds, of course, it's always all in our minds. There is no other way of experiencing life, if not passing through our body and our mind. So you can speak with the image of the ancestors that is projected by the light that crossed the water in the wall behind your altar. It's only one of our techniques. Another technique is instead inverting the place of the flame. So let's say that you are the practitioner, you have the water as the first thing in front of you, and you have a lit candle behind the water. So in this other situation, what we aim at is contemplating, as in the act of resting our mind, the flame through the water. This is what I often do. And guys, is symbolic of the overlapping of two worlds. The water represents, as we saw, the underworld, death, subconscious, the other side of the veil, while fire It's alive, it's warm, it's brilliant, it's what is in the surface right now. But we can also see this exactly at the opposite, because water is a symbol of life. We all are born from an ancient broth of water and salt, aren't we? And of course, a light candle can be a sign, a symbol of death, of what is past. How many times we light a candle to honor our deaths? Because it's not sunlight, it's not the light of day, but it's still a light, even in the darkness. The candlelight implies that there is a light in the darkness, differently from being at noon outside under the sun, isn't it? It's a light that we light. It's precious, isn't it? Doesn't light as much as the sun. So this is a possibility. Meditate, offer silence, listen to their voices, to their messages, either looking at the flame through the water bowl or looking. Do you see the projection of light on my face right now? I'm going up and down intentionally. Yes, you see it? Or we look at the reflection of the candle through the water on a wall nearby, behind. So this light slash fire slash electricity are the two elements that I consider necessary for an ancestral altar. Now, if you wanna come just as you are, you know you can. If you want to use an electric candle, absolutely you can. Your artwork with electricity, not with fire, indeed. So I have a couple of persons that are afraid of fire here for whatever reason. I assure you, it works regardless. You can use electric fire, you can use a lamp. If you feel safer this way, use this. Now, let's steal another few minutes, guys. I'll try to hurry up. There are five elements that I teach my students to have in an ancestor altar. If you can, we can just come with our body and that's plenty. But we have a division that we like to use in five elements. That will be the four alchemical elements: air, fire, water, earth. And the fifth element, which is ether, it's spirit, it's soul, it's Wagantanga. It's the source, the universe, the gods. Or if you don't wanna be religious about it, it's the feeling, it's the intention, it's our will. So the most basic thing we can do to have an ancestral altar is having us. The second step in complexity will be having a light and water. The third step is using the five elements to organize your altar. So, what corresponds to air? Air can be an offer of incense. Air can be an offer of any good smelling herb or wood. This is Palo Santo, which means holy branch, holy stuff, holy stick, holy pole. You can turn a cigar if you are honoring ancestors that loved the cigar. In Yoruba, for example, tobacco and cigars are often used in these ancestral altars. I personally can't stand cigars. Hate the smell. I'm not inclined to light a cigarette and offer it to the ancestors. But this is just me. If you feel like tobacco, cigars, and so on, it's a good idea for hair. By all means, absolutely, do what makes you happy. Another good offer for hair is flowers, and I specifically mean scented flowers. Don't go with the flowers that are pretty but smell like nothing, like my gorgeous baccarat roses. They are black, a blood red that is almost black. But they smell like nothing at all. So usually I wouldn't use them as air because air is also parfum and smell. So flowers that have a smell, that's good air. And what else? Bells, feathers, angel statues. If your power animal or your totem animal is a bird, you can have a representation of that animal, an eagle, a hawk, a sparrow, whatever you have, even a butterfly or any insect that flies. And if you are instead on the Christian path, you rather have angel figures, by all way. Put an image of your favorite angel with open wings or something that is tied with air, and that will work really well. Also, your noise-making tools are part of the air element. So, if you have like a cleansing bell, like this one that you used to open, that can be on your altar as air. And any rattling sound, any wind chime, anything that you wanna introduce, your rain bag, of course, if you made it, that can be referred as the object that represent air. And about water, we have of course the water that catalyze the ancestors. But you can choose to see the light and the water as spirit. Mostly, or the intent of our ritual. So you might decide to have also the elements around. In this case, you would use libation, for example, which means drinkable alcohol, usually that's rum or gin or anything that your ancestors might like. It can be vodka, it can be tequila, it can be amaretto di Saronno if you are Italian and your grandfather loved that. It can be also things like shells, which by the way you could use in your rain bag if you want. And it can be pearls, it can be sea glass. I love sea glass. I wish I had some. It can be any sort of libation that you used to share with them or that you saw them drinking, like my grandfather used to milk to mix water and wine when he was eating at the table. Do it. Do water and wine if your father, your grandfather liked that. It's okay. Don't mind it. It doesn't need to be an expensive bottle that you buy for this purpose. Ancestors don't pretend that you spend money on it. Just put your feelings. Don't go buy the crystal champagne. Actually, open something homey, like really the beer that they will drink. Or whatever you are drinking. That too is a very beautiful symbol. Sharing what you have, that's a good libation. Okay, let's pass to the symbol that is fire. Fire again can be seen as the light, as the electric candle. that we are using in the center to call the ancestors. I'm checking if there are questions. Hey, hi, Kim. Nice to see ya. Good. New faces, I love it. But beside the element of light slash fire and water, you can definitely have more candles, more light sources. If you see the altar I used in the picture that I gave you as an example here, I have fire, I have water, but I also have an electric candle. That was my symbol for fire. If you look in the image, top left, those sticks that you see is the Palo Santo I just showed you, that was air. And my water, in this case, is just the water that I have up there as a chalice, but I could have put a glass of beer or some other form of water symbol. For example, I could have used pearls, I could have used sea salt to symbolize sea, so water. There are many things we can use for any element. We don't have to be tied to just one thing. Another thing that can symbolize fire is any lava or stones that are not stones but crystallized lava, like for example obsidian. Obsidian is a glass, a black glass. It's the material of my runes that crystallize really quickly without cools down without many crystallization very quickly, and that creates that transparency. You can also have lava stones or other kinds, like this one. You can use water symbols when you do not have water if you wanna enrich your altar, and the same goes for fire. For example, if you do not want any sort of fire in your altars, you have kids, you have maybe animals, considering maybe a big red tiger eye. Or maybe jasper or blood hematite, which is that hematite that has a red splash. Anything that gives you the sensation of fire crystal-wise can substitute a candle in your altar if you feel the need. And what do we have for earth? Earth, if you look at this altar, my symbol of earth could have been both the skull of the bird or the pumpkin. Actually, it was the pumpkin. Now you might say, hey, that pumpkin is glass. Actually, it's a candle, even if it looks glass, but it's representative of earth because it's in the shape of a pumpkin. Usually, my earth offering on an ancestral altar is food. But in this situation, the food was symbolic. So it's earth because it represents an offering of food, but in reality, the offering itself would be a candle. Same, it's still energy. Burning a candle or dedicating to the ancestors a morsel of food, a cookie, whatever you used, sweets, it's still an offering on something that is tangible on this plane, and that you could have consumed. You could have lighted that incense, you could have lighted that candle for yourself, you could have ate that cookie, but you instead sacrifice that pleasure, utility, energy, form, because a pumpkin is energy, a candle is energy. And is your sacrificing that, making it sacred, sacro fare, sacred do. That is the offer. It's not the pulp of the pumpkin, it's not the wax of the candle. They don't need any of that. They want our gesture, our action, our sacrifice. That's why in my tradition, which means yours too, now that you're mine, A glass in the shape of a pumpkin can be an offer and it can definitely represent Earth, like all food. It's super late, it's 11:18. I'll give you just a last morsel of wisdom because it's super late. My boss is happy that I give you free time. She thinks that you will appreciate the extra time I give you, but I have a duty as a coach to stay within an hour, theoretically, even a little bit less. So I really wanna keep us in line time-wise. You know, you can reach me at coachingclubcafe.com if you really need me and you wanna connect to me in a deeper way. So the last little touch of wisdom I give you, it's introduce you to this salt. This is what I call blood salt. It's not blood. It's Hawaiian. Oh, Glamorgan, are you around? My boss, it's practical of Hawaii. She's been there many times for her formation, her training. She organizes retreats and seminars there, as you know, because I tell you every time I see ya. So I could really use her help or anybody that know how to pronounce Hawaiian in helping me pronunciate the name of this salt. This is written A-L-A-E-A. I know a bit of Maori because I like the culture, so I learned some of their akas, I studied a little bit of their poems. And my knowledge will say that this is pronounced Alaea, but I went to find the right pronunciation online and there was a bunch of robots that were just pronouncing it wrong, I'm sure, but I found a person that seemed native and she said Alai. So, is it Alaea or is it Alai? Somebody help here. Anyway, guys, Alai clay, red Alai clay is volcanic clay and it's very rich in minerals and iron. Do you remember what I told you about iron and it's tight with blood? What happens with this salt is that the salines where it's harvest are in the bottom in contact with red clay. Red clay, guys, that's earth, that's underground, that's cave, that's underneath the sea. Sea life underneath red clay, the realm of the underworld, Ade realm. This salt gets this blood runic red. This is really runic red, dry blood red, from the contact with red volcanic clay. This is a fantastic offer for the chain I told you earlier. Iron is earth in your blood, that is water carrying oxygen, which is air, so your cells produce energy, that is fire, and you can have your soul, which is spirit, incarnated here. And you know what's the difference from this and this with this? This is water. If I put salt in it, this becomes food. More about it. Becomes also symbolically blood because red salt, blood. So we can have offers of Alai salt in water, and then we take a sip, and it represents the blood of the ancestors. Like wine can represent blood of Christ in other religion, in the same way, we can have water and earth and represent a union and an offering and divide it. You don't have to drink it. Oh, you don't have to put this whole thing in the cup. It's symbolic. Just a little bit. You are not supposed to taste the salt really. You can have this offering of water and salt and use it to sprinkle your house, your corners, or you can have a sip of it and have all of your family members have a sip of it. This means blood of the ancestors and our blood. You can anoint your third eye with it without either drinking it or asperging it. You can use water and salt in many ways. Are you gonna change your water for the ancestors because you're doing the altar the whole time? Maybe instead of letting it run or throwing it in your garden, you can make salt and water and use it even in the mop to clean your house. Be creative. I hope that you had fun. I'm checking, guys, if you have any questions right now. Yes, Maria, tell me. Do you have a question for me, girl? Ask away. I'll give Maria a minute because she has a question. Before we wrap things up. So another mission I give to all of my gardeners of the soul this time is, guys, please help me found the correct version of pronouncing this. Okay, Maria is asking if she can use Himalayan salt, which is pink. Yes, you can. That's a splendid idea. Now, Himalayan salt, we'll have to do a show on salts, guys. I promise I will. God, it's almost an hour and a half. Donna, are you okay with me doing these things? Okay, so absolutely yes. Himalayan salt. Oh, it's Hawaiian. Oh, okay. Probably it's not the same. She's asking if it's the same salt. Probably not, because Alae has specifically blood color. So if yours is Hawaiian but pink, it's not this. Anyway, we are eclectic here, Maria. So use it. You know what else you would use? Another kind of Hawaiian salt. Let me show you really quickly. This one will work as well. You know why? Because pink, red, and green are all colors of the fourth chakra of your heart. This is still Hawaiian, and they make this by mixing it with the blood of plants, specifically bamboo, which is really, really rich in Hawaii. So anything that symbolizes a salt that works in the feelings, in the connection, in the family, in the heart chakra, you can use. Avoid blue salt, avoid gray salt. There is a situation in which you could go both ways, which is black Hawaiian salt, but my suggestion is to avoid it. Even if we use a lot of black for the ancestors, I want you to make the blood of the ancestors with something that can be related to the fourth chakra rather than black, if you can, or rather than white. That said, if you feel guided to break this rule, break it. If you have black salt and you feel you want to do your ancestor blood with water and black salt, do it. I'm not saying any dogma, no, here. You do you, but you follow my instructions, you'll do better. So yeah, ideally, Maria, ideally use Alae salt because not only what I said, but Hawaiians use this salt in ritual to cleanse, to purify, to bless tools, canoes, boats, houses, land, and also it's used in healing rituals, and it's very important for us to make a healing ritual of our practice with the ancestors, both for them and for us. So ideally, use the trick I gave you if you can. Otherwise, pink salt, Hawaiian is a very rich place. Oh, for you Americans, friends, watch out, because I know in California they produce this, they call it alae, and it's not. They make it in California mixing clay. Now, there is a specific power in Hawaii, guys. It's different to do alaea or alae, you'll tell me how it's pronounced, with the blood, the soil, the red volcanic clay of Pele or those gods, which are incarnated gods in land. Or go in any place and mix red clay and salt and say, hey, it is alae salt. No, it's not. There is a reason why there are sacred places, where there are charged power places in the world. There is a reason why we spend money to go there. Or we ask permission to the gods to bring a piece of that home. There is a difference from using this and other things. But if you don't have this, then you use what you have. Because we are chaotic magician and we fake it till we make it. And also, guys, if you really love nature, you will find beauty everywhere. And this was Laura Ingalls Wilder. Read her books. I need to go. It's been an hour and a half. I love you all, and I will answer to any question that you have for me now that I disconnect. I'll take time, even if you come in the following days, if you have a question, you watch my show, you have a question, or you leave it in the comments, I'll make sure to answer. Remember, you can find me at coachingclubcafe.com, waiting to see you all. I'll see you next Monday, same time. Have a good week. Blessed be.